Good morning, friends. This morning we're going to have a talk that might be triggering for some people. So some of you may not want to watch this particular one. Before we get into that, I do want to talk about coping strategies because I am having a really hard time coping with the isolation. In addition to the fact that I've not been feeling well and am taking antibiotics and my gut won't let me go take a long run or a long bike ride because there are no public restrooms right now, I've got to stay really close to the house. In addition to that, the weather's been crap, so I can't go out and work in the yard. I'll get soaking wet and pummeled with horizontal rain if I go out and run. Paddling's not going to happen right now for a couple of reasons. So what I'm going to do is my Garmin, he yells at me every hour and tells me to move. My Fitbit used to say this really nice, hey, want to take me for a walk? No, the Garmin just says move. So you see that treadmill back there? Yeah, I'm going to plug that in. And every hour when my Garmin says move, I'm going to go get on that thing for 10 minutes. I hate the thing, but I got to do what I got to do for my mental and my physical well-being. Okay, this is the part where a lot of people might want to just go ahead and tune out if you don't want to talk about something sensitive. And today I want to talk about ventilators. Those who know me well know that I was a paramedic for 13 years. I worked flight for life. I worked ground ambulance. I was the only paramedic in southeastern Utah when I worked for the Park Service, working under the authority of the Trauma Center in Grand Junction, Colorado. I've done everything from urban knife and gun club to remote wilderness rescue. And one thing that I have seen far too many times is people who face an illness, an injury, an accident at the end of their life without a plan. And you don't want to do that. There's been a lot of talk in the news lately about ventilators and that there aren't enough ventilators. So the first question you really want to ask yourself, and you should want to ask yourself this at any time, I recently had to think about this and work on redoing this when I had a health scare earlier this year. Haven't gone over this since 2011 when I had surgery and potentially had cancer and didn't know how I would react to general anesthesia and needed to make sure that I had all my affairs in order. Well, having your affairs in order just isn't having a will. And it isn't necessarily even just telling your loved ones what you want. It's having it documented. So the first thing when people are terminally ill or have a condition that could turn terminal and they're under a doctor's care, the first thing they look for is a do not resuscitate order. If you go down, do you want to be resuscitated? And that is a question that varies wildly from everything between someone's age, do they have children to take care of, to their religious beliefs. Some people very strongly believe that you protect human life at all costs. I've got a lot of opinions on that, but I'm not gonna go there today. That's not the purpose of this. I know what my choices are for me. So what do you want to have happen if you code in the hospital, or if you code at home and the ambulance has to come? For me, I can't count the number of people that I watch die. I can't count the number of people that I saved or brought back, only to have them code again over and over and over in the unit. Brain death occurs 4 to 6 minutes of your brain being deprived of oxygen. 4 to 6 minutes. The likelihood of being successfully resuscitated and having a functional brain, unless you're dealing with hypothermia from a cold water drowning, it's not gonna happen. So what do you want your family and loved ones to go through? I've watched family and loved ones when their relative that I saved in the unit code over and over and over again. And the family goes through that horror over and over again. So that's something to think about right there. Number one, do you want to be resuscitated if you go down? And this is not just for what's going on now. This is it all. A choice you might make if you're terminally ill, if you're older, if you don't have family to be there for, that's going to be a much different choice than someone who's got children to be there for. That's a whole different fight. Everybody's decisions on that is different. But it needs to be documented, and your state has different rules about what constitutes a valid do not resuscitate order should you want one. So you're going to need to Google DNR or do not resuscitate order for your state to find out what you need to do if that is something that you want to pursue. The next most important document that we can all have is advanced directives, and that literally talks about end of life care. It goes beyond resuscitation. Say you responded to CPR and a round of cardiac drugs. Do you want to be fed through a tube in your nose? Do you want to be hooked up to a ventilator? At what point do you consider extraordinary measures to be cruel and unusual punishment? Now we have my alarm. I get to wake up now. I've not been sleeping well. So the advanced directives, they're gonna do a couple of things. They're gonna talk about, do you wanna be on a ventilator? Do you wanna be fed through a tube in your nose? Do you wanna be put in an extended care facility? You can literally define exactly what you do or don't want done in an advanced directive. Now you're gonna have to have that signed and witnessed by two people. If you don't have one yet, you're going to have to fill it out, and you're going to have to put it on your porch, and you're going to have a friend come sign it. You have to sanitize it before they sign it and sanitize after they drop it off. It's some peace of mind. I know that my ideas and thoughts and opinions on all of this are jaded by a lot of years of being a first responder and an emergency medical person. And if you have children to take care of, And you want to fight with everything you've got and wait for that miracle, by all means do it. For me, I don't. I'm going to be closing in on 60 in 2.5 years. I don't have any children. I don't have any close family. I have a half-sister that I've met once, and I have cousins that live in another state. But I don't have anybody that I have to stay alive for. Is my job considered important? Yeah, it is. But you know what? They can train somebody else to do it. So I don't have any reason to take up resources or to put my loved ones through me potentially coding over and over again, like some other people do. So my advanced directives very clearly say, you can do CPR, you can defibrillate me, you can give me a round of cardiac drugs. If that's it, you don't get to put me on a ventilator, and you never get to feed me through a tube shoved up my nose. That's my choice. It may not be your choice. But the point is, the time to take charge of your choice is before your family is put into the situation to deal with that. And if you don't have advanced directives, you may tell your partner, your loved ones, what you want, but some family member that is not even close to them, it could even be a family member that they are estranged from, they have more legal rights than you do, and they can come in and make all the decisions, even if it's 100% against what your loved one wants. And they can even ban you from seeing them. I saw this a lot before gay marriage was legalized. And say what you will about gay marriage, but when two people love each other and are committed to each other and are building a home together, to see that loving partner kept from being with their loved one at the end of their life because of a family member who doesn't believe their relationship is right, you don't want to see that. So make sure that everything is done in writing and is legal in your state. So you want to look up do not resuscitate order for your state, and you want to look up advanced directives for your state. The other thing that you want to look up is you want to have a will. The will is for after you die. What do you want done with whatever you have? it may not be a lot. There may be certain things that you want to give to somebody. There may be a piece of artwork that you want to give to a beloved friend. You may have a home that will be sold and the proceeds go to a charity or to a family member. So, and no, you don't have to have a lawyer draw up a will. I mean, if you think it's going to be contentious, by all means do. I did my will. I pulled up a form online and I filled it out. And I did take it down to my bank and have it notarized, even though it's not legally required in most states to have the will notarized. But you want that, Darren. And the other thing, in addition to the advanced directives, and this can also be listed on the advanced directives, is the power of attorney. Who's going to make these decisions for you if you can't make those decisions yourself? Is it a spouse? Is it a child? Is it a sibling? Or like me, do you not have anybody that close to you? And did you have to go around and ask your friends, hey, who loves me as much as you love your dog and wouldn't let me suffer? Because you're going to have to pick one, probably two people that are going to be the ones to say, if this is what you choose, yeah, it's time to pull the plug. Also, you want to go ahead and Google durable power of attorney for your state. Get the forms, find out what the process is. Does it have to be notarized? Then the other thing that most people don't realize is all of this has to be where it's going to be useful. Your doctor's office needs to have it. If you are terminally ill, if you are very, very sick, those things need to be right where first responder can see it. And a first responder, depending on your state, may or may not be able to honor that do not resuscitate order. Having been a paramedic myself, I wish I could have do not resuscitate tattooed to my chest. So documents. The people who hold your power of attorney should have all your documents. Your family, if you have family, should have all your documents. Your doctor's office should have all your documents. Additionally, keep all your documents in an envelope and put it someplace that it can be easily found in your house. I've had mine actually taped up on the refrigerator because people need to be able to find it. Okay, I know this was really morbid. I know this isn't the usual, hey, we're all gonna get through this together, check on your friends. But these are very, very important things that we don't think about until it's too late. So think about it now. It's even a little more important right now because, again, circling back to the beginning of this, people talk about if this is worst case scenario, there won't be enough respirators. For me, I don't want to be on a respirator anyway. I decided that 30 years ago. Not for me, no reason to be. So why would I take up that respirator when the mother of three small children might need it and she might recover because she's younger than I am? Anyway, those are all choices that we have to make. These are things that we have to think about in good times and in bad times. And since a lot of us have spare time on our hands now, now's the time to do it. And I can't emphasize enough, every state's rules for all of these things are different. So Google all of these items with your state. And that's do not resuscitate order, advanced directives, power of attorney, and will. And that's it for today. I'll try to have something cheerier tomorrow. Hang in there, friends.